Hey everyone, and welcome to episode 38. My name is Keshav and I'm the producer. Today's episode is with Sasha Paikin, who is a 2021 Dalhousie graduate and current Master's of Real Estate student at Cornell University, where she is currently focusing her studies on real estate development and sustainability. She joined Sam to discuss her time living in Halifax and studying at Dal and contrasting that with now living in New York and studying at Cornell, and also her progression as an individual throughout the past several years. I've linked to a couple of articles Sasha has written that was referenced in the episode, so feel free to take a look at those in the description of the episode, and as well, contact information to connect directly with Sasha. Thanks and enjoy.
Hello, Sasha Paikin. It's like bacon with a P. Thank you.
Yes.
Welcome.
Thank you. It's good to see you again.
Very good to see you again. Oh, okay. Where do we start? Well, we'll first start with our icebreaker question. Not super creative today, but I would like to know what your favorite vegetable is.
Oh, that's a great question. I think it's broccoli, and it has always been broccoli.
Is there a story behind this? Like, did one day, like, your parents catch you with, like, a head of broccoli just, like, chowing down, or?
No, I just really liked it as a kid, and I think I was the only kid who liked it, so it became, like, you know, an oddity, something that was remembered.
Yeah, no, I like that, too. I had a friend that loved milk, and my mom loved that she loved milk, so she would just be like, oh,
every time she comes over, have like gallons of milk.
It's very true. And my friend like loved it so much. And like they had like a bigger family, so they didn't always have like a ton of milk to like drink all the milk. So my mom loved it, my friend loved it, and I was just sitting there like, well, like I like chocolate milk and that's about it. So I could get like scratch that. But okay, my follow-up question to that is an avocado a fruit or a vegetable?
I think it's a fruit.
So too, because that would have been my answer, but then I would have been like, oh, I don't know.
Yeah, I think it's if it has a pit, it's a fruit.
All right. Well, this is good. Not the first time I learned something from Sasha Paikin. But maybe now would be a good opportunity for you to let the crowd know, listeners know, how do we know each other?
Yeah, we know each other from way back in 2018, I guess, when I was in my first year at Dal in the Bachelor of Commerce program. And yeah, and I believe it was your first semester teaching too. You taught me introductory management accounting. And I took one more class with you after that. I think I took cost accounting with you in third year. But then I did not go on to be an accounting major, but we stayed friends.
Yeah, no, absolutely. Kind of a good thing to highlight is you can continue having relationships with your profs if you want. You can also not, but even if you don't decide to quote be in their major or have another class with them, like it's all okay. I always say that we're not on commission. It's not like the more accountants we put out into the world, like we don't get karma points or salary bumps and in fact, honestly, I like that people don't go into accounting, because the last thing I would want is that people go into it because of me or because of something else, because of anything else other than them wanting to or seeing it as a tool to further themselves. So the fact that you have come on here and we're going to have a discussion about your journey through undergrad and where you're at right now is really, really good, not only for me, but for hopefully our listeners. We have a number of people going into fourth year that maybe are like, well, I've done cost, I've done, you know, IFA one, but like the next 40 years of doing accounting is something that I would hate doing. Okay, cool. Like here's some options, and let's hear kind of about how you took yourself through undergrad. I would also just kind of caveat on that is that it's never too late. You know, if you are like in 5 years and you're like, accounting, like the skill set follows. So Sasha, where are you at like right now physically, but also kind of where are you at as far as when did you graduate and what was your path like to get where you're at right now?
Yeah, so right now physically I'm in Toronto. I'm working here for the summer. at an investment firm called Fengate. I just finished my first year doing a master's of real estate at Cornell, and I went into that immediately after I graduated from Dal in 2021. So yeah, how did I get there? That's a good question, because
what were your co-ops like? I remember your first one was, was it Show Me Your Purple?
Yes, I did my first co-op at Grant Thornton. That's a good memory, yeah.
U.S. Tax?
U.S. Tax, yeah. Mm-hmm. So I really tried with accounting. I worked in it. Even the summer after first year, I did, I worked at an accounting firm in Burlington where I'm from for the summer. And then I did my first co-op in U.S. Tax at Grant Thornton. My second co-op, I stayed in Halifax, and I was a due diligence intern at Beaumont Advisors. And then my third co-op, I did investment banking at Scotiabank. So I went somewhere different for every co-op, which I would highly recommend to anyone in a co-op program, because I learned so much throughout those co-ops. And actually the co-op that I least expected to learn the most from, I still use that knowledge today more than anything else. I don't know if that came out very clearly, but my second co-op it ended up being my most useful for what I ended up doing, which was very unexpected to me.
Okay, so just to draw, like to paint the picture completely, because linear is overdone. So you're at Cornell. Did you state what your master's is in?
I think so. Master's of Real Estate.
Master's of Real Estate at Cornell. Mm-hmm. So you have a Bachelor of Commerce, General Management, just Bachelor of Commerce, yeah, not just, general but commerce. No major, general.
Correct.
And you've had two essentially work terms, or one official work term in accounting, one in due diligence, and one in finance at an iBank. And yet you've said that the experience there, you would highly recommend doing varied, and that one of them, and my follow-up one will be which one, has actually led to a ton of useful experience for where you're at right now. Mm-hmm. So what I really want to highlight here, and I apologize if this is pedantic, but so often we feel like, oh, I need to do A, then B, then C. And it sounds like you've done like a little bit of A this, a little bit of F this, a little bit of M, and now you're at O. And so could you kind of explain a little bit more, starting with which one had led to the most kind of beneficial to where you're at right now?
Yeah, so my second co-op, that was the one where I knew I didn't want to do another one in accounting. I kind of wanted to transition over to finance, but I didn't know exactly in what capacity. So that co-op where I did a due diligence internship, it was due diligence into hedge funds and private equity funds on behalf of institutional investors. And I am now working for a private equity fund that invests on behalf of institutional investors. So I didn't anticipate it going into the going into the work term, because I saw due diligence intern and I was like, I don't really know what that means, honestly. Yeah. But I went for it anyways, because I was like, this seems like a good way to learn about finance and the fun side of finance, which I didn't know anything about at the time. And now I never would have guessed that that would have been really the route that I ended up choosing out of my three co-ops.
Awesome. Mm-hmm. So sometimes students will say to me, I need to do a major. I need to do a major. And you did not have a major. Can you kind of talk a bit about why you decided to go without quote of a major, and how that has either facilitated or limited options for you?
Yes. That's a great question, because I still, even after I completed it, I still wondered if I made the right decision. But I ended up not doing a major because I had all these different courses that I wanted to take, and they were all in different majors, and I didn't want to give up certain courses in order to fit into one of the streams. So for example, I took your cost accounting course because I liked your first class and I wanted to take another class with you. And I ended up learning a lot from that class, even though, yeah, I didn't follow that route, but I didn't want to take an accounting major just to take that course. mind you, after I graduated and I realized that I wasn't going to go back to investment banking, I was kind of like, shoot, like maybe I should have stuck with the accounting route, because if I had the major, I could have maybe pursued my CPA, even though I didn't initially plan on doing that. Yeah, but in the end, I don't think that would have been right for me. I think it would have been a fine backup plan if I couldn't decide still, or I didn't end up finding the route that I went to. But so if I would say that a advantage to the major is that you have that specialization almost to rely on if you aren't sure where you want to branch out to. But I still really appreciated getting the opportunity to take courses in each of the different concentrations at Dal. I took accounting courses, finance courses, entrepreneurship courses, I took a family business course. Like I kind of took everything, and because I was still deciding, I was still trying to figure it out. And I was really glad that I did that, because it kind of gave me a taste of everything. And even though I kind of figured out what I wanted more of when it was too late, at least I figured out what I wanted more of, you know?
Oh my gosh. And you say too late. I mean, worst case scenario, and like, this is, I don't say this lightly because I know our tuition is very expensive, but worst case, you either take a fifth year and do a major, or you, or somebody graduates and works and maybe takes like, you know, some additional school if need be, or they find out, hey, I'm going to work in the field and then maybe pursue a master's in that field. You know, there's so many, many things, but I really appreciate, most about your answers, especially the beginning where I could kind of see your thought process of being like, yeah, like I would, you almost brought yourself back there and like, yeah, I didn't know what I wanted. Perhaps I should have had a backup plan, but I decided that the backup plan would have hurt my forward plan. So I made a balanced analysis and I went for it. And I think a lot of what we see, even in our cost class, is it's cost benefit. And it's like, cool, it's not just the numbers, but it's also the, you know, the pro con, the qualitative factors. And I would say that, you know, kudos to you for really putting the time in the decision and putting yourself and your first plan first and foremost, because, you know, you are now completing your master's at an Ivy League university, and, you know, working and pursuing something that's more, that's in line with your first plan and not part of your backup plan. So, you know, thank you for sharing. And I know that it's not easy, right?
Yeah. And I will add, I was also worried about the general commerce, like undeclared major, because I was worried that it would make my resume look weaker. And I will note that that has not been the case at all. I've actually never had anyone comment on the fact that I didn't take a major. So if you're worried about that, or if that's something that you're considering, know that that has not been my reality.
Thank you. I've had actually, that answers a direct student question. That is, great. You know, they were like, I need to take a major. Like, what are people going to think? And it's like, do you want? Which major do you want? Well, like, I just want one. And it's like, okay.
Exactly.
And I get it. They're just coming out of their second year. And I get it, because you feel like you have to. But I almost wish that perhaps, we'll start the trend here where it's like, you know, make goals, see how the major fits in versus trying to, you know, do the quotes, all the right things in a linear fashion. Because, you know, if you ended up finding yourself in a position where you were asked the question, I'm sure that you could share your rationale and be like, yeah, I get that. Like, you had a lot of cool things, and, you know, limiting yourself because it's like 6 major courses for accounting and possibly similar for the others. Like that's a lot of commitment for something that is not your first plan.
Yeah, exactly. As long as you had a plan or some sort of thought process going into it, then it's totally a valid answer.
Absolutely. All right. So do you use accounting in your current gig at all? And actually, I'm going to hold that right here. Because did you use accounting? I maybe this isn't you, maybe this is somebody else, but I could have sworn that the iBanking interview is intensive. Would you agree?
Yes.
Was it you who said that a large, or not like a decent chunk of your interview had some accounting in it?
I don't think that was me who said that, but I could see it being true. because it does touch a lot on our introduction to finance course, which has accounting principles in it. Like, you know, in accounting, you end up calculating like an NPV. That's part of accounting, even though you learn it in finance, but it carries forward and you need to know how to do that for any sort of commerce.
Yes, maybe not like a lot of accounting, but if there was some, it was probably more than they thought.
So. Yeah. And even though it, separately from the interview, though, I did definitely use it in the role. So, yes.
Well, good to know. All right. Mm-hmm. And do you use any kind of accounting principles or anything for either the intros or the cost management in your current gig at all?
I do.
Either a current gig being like master's or your current kind of work term. You do?
Both. Yeah, for sure. In pretty much in any role I've found where you're dealing with numbers, pretty much you're going to be looking at financial statements. And if you know your way around those, then you are in so much better shape than everyone else around you. And even going to the US and not having the class background knowledge of US accounting principles, it's very transferable if you know the Canadian stuff to kind of figure it out. And I did get a little bit of the US knowledge when I was doing US tax and in my iBanking role, so that helped a little bit.
Yeah, cool. All right, Sasha, we heard a lot about your work, a lot about your education. Is there any time for fun in here?
Yes, there is.
What does that look like?
Of course there is.
Yeah, of course there is. Good.
Well, it's been very nice being back in Toronto because I've gotten to reconnect with a lot of friends who I haven't seen in a while. I'm actually living with my best friend from high school who we haven't had a chance to live in the same city since high school. So that's been really, really nice. There's definitely room for fun. My go-to answer for that always used to be rock climbing, but I have since injured myself, and so I haven't been rock climbing in a while. But I've been seeing friends. I've been able to go home and see my family. And just kind of exploring Toronto. I finally get to live in downtown Toronto, which I never got to do because of COVID. So it's been a lot of fun.
Is it because I've only stayed in downtown Toronto for work on a few occasions. And I remember being very, very conducive to being a pedestrian. But then again, I wasn't like walking too far. I was like walk hotel to work and restaurant and back and stuff. So would you say it's very pedestrian?
Yes, I would. Which has actually been very nice. I'm lucky enough that my friend lives very close to my office. So I walk to work every day, which is lovely. And it's really close to the waterfront, really close to Union Station. So I can get home to Burlington whenever I want to. I have been liking Toronto a lot more than I expected to, honestly.
Cool. Oh my gosh. Is it upstate New York that Cornell is located in? I should have done a quick little Google beforehand because my geography
is bad. It is. Yeah.
What's it like living there?
I really like it. I really like being outdoors and, you know, hiking and swimming and things like that. So it's great for me. I was deciding between that program and Columbia's program in New York City. So those would have been two very different lifestyles. Cornell's in Ithaca, which is a pretty small city, is right in the under Cayuga Lake and the Finger Lakes. So it has a really beautiful scenery around it. Students make up a very large portion of the population of the city, which is really nice. And it's very much like a small town campus atmosphere, kind of similar to Dal. So yeah, I've been loving it there. It's really beautiful, but kind of hard to get to.
Fair. Alrighty. So what are your future plans or options that you're considering?
Yeah. So unlike in my undergrad, I am doing a concentration for grad school. This is a 2-year program. So I just finished my first year. I have 1 year left after this internship. And I'm doing a concentration in real estate development and sustainability. So a large reason I came to do this program is because I got a lot of the finance background from my undergrad, but I didn't get the real estate side or like the development focus side. And a lot of that kind of has to do with like, or a lot of what I'm interested in that in sustainability has like some engineering concepts in it that I've never even thought of before. So the program's been really helpful for me in getting more of that side of my knowledge. So my plan for after this is I haven't decided exactly where. I'm contemplating New York City or maybe coming back to Toronto or maybe somewhere else entirely. I'm not sure, but I would love to work at a real estate development firm and help them become more sustainable while I'm there.
Fabulous. Tell me a bit about the blog, because I've seen it come up a couple times on LinkedIn, but you are, maybe explain a bit about your role and how you came to be there and the different articles that you pursue and how those come to be.
Yeah, this is actually one of my favorite things that I've done at Cornell so far. So Cornell has what's called the Cornell Real Estate Review, which is their online newspaper or blog, completely written by current students in my program. And usually there will be a couple of second year students who are the editors and then some first year students who are writers. So I was one of those writers this year, and you pretty much get to write about whatever you want. So we cover certain things related to the program, like guest speakers who will come in will write a synopsis on their lecture, or we go on treks and we'll write a synopsis on those. But for the blog posts and for the journal that we publish in the end of the school year, you get free rein and you get to work with the second years and help improve your piece, and you get to work with professors and they help you figure out not only like the scope of your piece, but also what you want it to accomplish. And so for me, having taking so many core classes this year that don't have as much of a sustainability focus, which is what I'm really interested in, this was how I supplemented my education in order to cover those topics. So it, yeah, if you saw any of the articles I wrote, you'll see that they are all about sustainability.
I'll link to some down below too.
Oh, great. Yeah. I wrote about financing sustainable development in the fall. In the spring, I did a case study on the Cornell Tech campus in New York City and how they've implemented sustainability. And then it hasn't been published yet, but our journal should be coming out anytime now. And I have a piece in that as well. And that those are longer, more research focus. Those are much more intensive than the blog pieces that we put out. So that's what I spent majority of my time working on, and that's where I did majority of my learning.
Fabulous, fabulous. I love that. So being able to use your core competencies, use your core skills, and then also kind of build on other opportunities to explore things that you're passionate about, still within that realm, but like just kind of go heavy and create your own learning opportunities and ways to contribute within the framework. So fabulous. Mm-hmm.
And also Dal has a Dal Business Review, and I never wrote for the review because I was like, oh, I'm more of a numbers person. Writing isn't really my strong suit. Mm-hmm. And I would say that that was very foolish of me, because that's how you get better at writing, by practicing it. And it's just like, you know, the writing is more of an afterthought to what you're learning throughout this process. And especially if you're interested in something that you don't find a course that's directly applicable to it, this is a really fantastic way to learn about it for yourself, but then also you can use this in interviews and on your resume. This has come up pretty much everywhere I go. Like, this has come up more than anything else that I've done probably my entire life. But it's great because it's me showing people this is exactly what I want to do and what I'm interested in. And here's me proving how passionate I am about it.
Yeah, it's so first of all, I can completely relate. In fact, here's even you've learned in what, like a year, what it took me over a decade to kind of learn, because when I picked my undergrad classes and probably my CA still, it was like, Does it have an essay? Nope. Does that have group work? Yep. Nope. And I'm like, fabulous. Really big exam. Love it. Yeah. That won't Same. Be stressful at all. That'll build up one skill set.
Yep.
But yeah, writing is an afterthought. If you're writing about the writing for writing's sake is not something that gets me jazzed. But if it's sharing, if it's another mm-hmm. avenue, so you can write something, you can have a blog, podcast and something, but it's all like, it helps kind of organize your thoughts so that when you're out there communicating, I think they say clear writing is clear thinking and clear speaking is clear writing or something to that effect. So it all kind of builds together. So if you look at the writing as an opportunity to kind of succinctly, you know, build up your case, build up your narrative, and as a way of sharing and showcasing, bonus that initiatives like the Dow Business Review or the blog at Cornell and the journal, these are not things that you have to do. So it further showcases to potential employers or collaborators, like, hey, I'm the kind of person who does things that aren't mandatory because I've done something that isn't mandatory. So it's a great win-win-win. Like, here's my excitement, my passion, and a way to kind of put my time and showcase where I'm at. So cool. Thanks for sharing that.
Yeah, of course. And different from other clubs, it's something that you actually have like proof when you're done, you know. You can say, yeah, I led this club and we had this event and it was great, but there isn't really any proof technically to anyone else, even though that's also a very valuable experience and also gets a lot of credit as it should. But the advantage of something like this is that, you know, there is written evidence of exactly what you learned and exactly how you presented it.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. You can send a link and it's mm-hmm. evidence. And honestly, something that I've come to appreciate putting together my CV in an academic environment is like, I'm proud to show like, oh, this is what I've done. Like I am. And even things that, you know, years ago, I'm like, why would you do that differently now? I'm proud that I've grown that much. So, because who wants to be the same person in 5 years, right? And produce the same things. Like I want to produce better, and it helps. I don't know about you, but knowing that there might be a chance to share something in the future helps kind of, I don't know, direct my future energy towards different projects and different decision-making.
Yeah. Cool. Yeah, completely agree.
Alrighty. I think I know the answer to this, but I'm going to ask it anyways. Do you regret taking accounting courses?
Definitely not. I don't. I will never regret taking an accounting course, even if this wasn't the case for me. But if you're in one right now and you're like, man, I have regrets afterwards, you will not. So I will say the same for finance courses, honestly, but accounting especially. It's very underrated really in comparison to finance. Because even if you want to go into finance, you need accounting. And if you have accounting, there is just, you have that basis of understanding to really help you speed up your learning in other avenues. So yeah, I honestly don't know how people, I don't know how people go without a good understanding of accounting and hold like, I don't know, leadership roles at businesses or anything to do in a business. It's just accounting will come up at some point, even if it's just doing your own taxes. So it's so useful to have that knowledge.
Yeah, I'm happy to hear you say that. And also like acknowledging I'm fully biased. but I will say that the amount of confidence of people that have taken accounting, regardless if they decide to pursue it further or not, when they see a number, they at least know, okay, this is who I can ask, or this is like, this is my professional skepticism. I made an argument about something that will lead to the betterment of hopefully our accounting major and our university. And I based it in numbers based on accounting, based on relevant costs. And somebody's like, oh yeah, I can add up relevant costs. It's like, yeah, but how do you capture foregone opportunities, you know, sunk costs, opportunity costs, and how do you make it into a coherent argument that somebody who doesn't have our background understands in a way that's accessible. Mm-hmm. I was in a job once and all the things that came in with a number was given to the quote, the accountant. Well, that eventually led to a very senior position because I wasn't allergic to numbers. I was like, sure, bring them on in. I might not like solve your problem, but I can like direct it. So it's useful even when it's a part of your toolkit and not your only tool.
Definitely. Yeah.
So right now we have a number of students entering in their fourth year. We also might have some students entering into their third year or taking a fifth year. So just in general, accounting majors, non-accounting majors, what would advice would you have for current DAL management students?
Ooh, great question. We kind of touched on this already, but I think one thing that's very obvious in my journey is that indecisiveness is okay.
Yes. Oh my god. Could you imagine if somebody had, like, if Sasha at like 20 had her whole life figured out?
and
you stuck to it?
There were so many times where I made a plan and I was like, this is it. You know, this is the one. This is what I'm gonna do, and none of this is gonna change, and it's gonna work perfectly. And then I get a little ways into that plan and I'm like, oh, I don't know, you know? Like, my plan has changed so many times. Even when I was at Dal and it was time to pick your courses, I think I would make like 6 different schedules and then I wouldn't be able to decide which one was the best. So I would definitely say I know that there's often a lot of stress, especially when you're right around graduation time or if you're at any major decision in your academic experience. And it's okay, just know that it's okay to not know. Just try what you think is best. And once you go down that path, reevaluate. Yes. And just make sure that you're constantly reevaluating. And yes. Then if you're worried about, say, spending too much time on a path that you don't eventually want to be on, that's okay, because no matter what, you will learn from that experience. And as long as you're always like consciously thinking about what you're doing, what you like about it, what you don't like about it, it doesn't matter if, like, nothing is wasted experience. Even if you completely switch industries, you will learn from that. And that will have been a stepping stone on your journey to where you end up going.
Completely. At this time, I think we should, I don't know. Don't be mad. I will try not to make this super embarrassing, but I want to talk a bit about your varied, I don't want to call them hobbies, but I don't want to call them accomplishments, but like your varied adventures. So it was like second or third year, you invited Eric and I to what that you were a part of?
Oh yeah. Oh my gosh. You asked me about my hobbies and I feel like you're
right. No, no, it's okay. This is my job. You talk about Sasha, I'll ask the question.
Yeah. So when I was at Dal, I've always loved theater and I didn't study theater. I didn't end up pursuing that in a professional way, but it was still something I loved doing. So I was in a few musicals in Halifax and I ended up inviting Sam to one of them and you came, which was so nice.
Of course. And I cheered loud.
Yeah. Yes, you did. And it was just a really, really great way to supplement my time at Dal because it was something I always loved doing. And I was worried that if I didn't study that or I didn't pursue that professionally, it was something that I would lose. And the only thing that made me lose that was COVID. And it was because everyone had to lose that during COVID. And it was a very dark time and very hard for artists and people who had pursued that for their career. And I totally empathize with them. I lost it as just a hobby and it really affected me. So I would say there are so many ways to do things outside of your current career path and things that you may have done since you were a kid or things you've never done before, but you've always been interested in. It's so nice to like live your life in that well-rounded way and not always prioritize work or, you know, academic success. There's time for other things.
Would you, now maybe a hot take, is it time management, energy management, both or neither, in your opinion?
Ooh.
I know, right?
Both.
But
I like energy management. I don't think I've ever heard that before, actually. But I think that is a way better term than time management because energy, like when you choose what to put your energy into, you'll find the time for it. Whereas if you're always thinking in terms of time, I feel like that's less productive. So yeah, this was a priority for me. And so I made sure to make that happen in addition to school. And I like that. Yeah.
Thank you. well, it's because it's like, talk about this with one of my like friends who had a parallel career up until academia. But it's like something either, if it's not giving, it's taking away. And we kind of talk about that in terms of like relationships, like, you know, it's good to give and take. And like, that's what you want ideally. And sometimes you give more and sometimes you take more, but like in general, if something is not kind of giving, it's taking away from your time or your energy elsewhere. And so when people talk about work-life balance, I have a hard time being a proponent for that in general, because to me, that's almost looking at time as a limited resource, which it absolutely is. But some people would look at, you know, like right now it's almost 8 o'clock at night. And this is, quote, is it part of my job? Is it not part of my job? I don't know, but this is something I want to do. Like there's no place else that I would rather be on a Tuesday evening than talking and catching up with you and sharing with our learners. So, you know, but to somebody, this might be work. So for me, it's more like if it's not giving, it's taking. If it's not filling up the cup, it's draining the cup, you know? So it really is that energy balance. So yeah, that's kind of how I've come to live about it. But possibly that's just me justifying working too much earlier on. But also I don't feel like anything was lost, if that makes any sense.
No, there's also nothing wrong with putting 100% of yourself into work, because that works for some people. But yeah, that's very true. I just know that I find that once I put my energy into things that I get energy back from, that's a great way of putting it, then I'm able to do so much more because I don't get drained in everything that I do.
Yeah, no, completely. Okay, so this is going to go in a slightly different direction. You can take it however you want, but you both participated in a, quote, Olympic event in fourth year, but you also were the president of an association. So, you know, it sounded like you had a lot going on while also kind of figuring things out along the way. So take that in whatever direction you will.
Yeah, I mean, I did have a lot going on. So yeah, when I was in fourth year, I was the president of the Dalcom Society. And that was a really great way for me to reconnect with my classmates, despite an online learning environment, and also to connect with classmates that I hadn't yet. Somehow I made it to fourth year and I realized how many of my fellow comm kids
it's a big program.
I know it is a big program, but also in another sense, it's not that huge. Like, I think when we graduated, I don't at all know if this is true, but I assume we had around 250 students in our year.
It's ballpark, yeah.
Okay. And so there are programs with thousands of students graduating each year. And I feel like at Commerce, we have a community, and I didn't take as much advantage of that in the preceding years of my degree. So I was really happy for that opportunity to, you know, get to know my classmates a little bit better. And yeah, and I was able to do that even during our online year. So I was really grateful for that. I don't know what direction I'm taking this in, but
no, that's perfect.
I think it's a way to just say, you know, enjoy your time while you're at Dal, and make sure you're at Dal while you're at Dal. Like, really, you know, buy into the atmosphere, buy into what you're doing there, put more energy in, and you will get more energy out of it. Like, it all circles around. And I feel so much more connected to the commerce program at Dal because I had that experience. Even though I was involved before, it's just in a different way when you have more responsibility in that context.
Absolutely. I feel like you invested, you know, earlier on too, in being a part of things, and then eventually led to leading things. So you were a part of the accounting JDCC team for the case comps and involved in, first year, you're PepsiCo, right? You were part of the PepsiCo first year case challenge, the winning team.
Yes, I was.
Oh my gosh, these things. Who else is part of your team? I forget.
In first year was me and Allie and Laura.
I thought it might have been. Okay, friends of the podcast. Cool. Awesome. So yeah, it's at the same time, how did you pick and choose what you were involved in? Because, you know, when we're talking about the things that you were involved in, we aren't necessarily highlighting the things that you weren't involved in. So how did you kind of like, what was your kind of decision matrix, if you will, to like say, oh yes, I will do that, but like, then I won't do that?
Yeah, it was hard. That was always my challenge. I know at the time, JDCC was always an easy choice for me because even though it was very on and off during my time at Dal, I just knew that I loved case competitions right away in first year when I did it. And then I did PepsiCo and I'm still doing case competitions in grad school. Nice. So yeah, I've always loved those. I think it's partially because of the theater part of me, you know, you're kind of performing when you're up there presenting. So I've always loved that. But I found that I usually picked one priority and then I would try to just figure out what else I was interested in and had time for. And then I would usually do too much anyways. And this is not a problem I've outgrown. I am still doing this in grad school and it's something that I've been working on. And I know that there are people like yourself, I'm sure, who share this struggle where we want to do so much and then we do too much and then we can't give anything up. So we just end up doing too much. Yeah,
it's something to give us energy.
So true.
Yeah. Although I will say, I feel like, and this is where the Olympics comes into play, is that you also made fun a priority in your fourth year.
Yes.
Yeah. So, you know, whether it was like hosting like a social event or, you know, you worked hard, but you also made sure to kind of incorporate what you consider to be fun. And I want to say that of the things, because like we do tend to sometimes, you know, glamorize the things that can go on a CV. I want to say like when I met up with you and we went for brunch and stuff and I heard about these different things, like I was super, super proud. And even just now hearing when you say is like, when you're a Dal, be a Dal. Like, yes, because so often we can focus on something at the expense of another. So I really loved that you were present, you know, throughout all of that.
I was wondering what you're referencing with the Olympics. And I was like, I think I have an idea, but I'm not quite sure. So I would say that a big reason that I wasn't as connected with my commerce class is in my first few years at university, I think I was just way too academic focused. And I broke out of that a little bit in fourth year. And I was like, you know what, like, this is my last year of my undergrad. I need to have fun while I'm here. Like, what the heck, it's COVID now, everything's closed right when I want it to be open. And yeah, kind of allowing myself to have more fun and meet more people and go out with more friends. That was something that I really value because it allowed me to learn about a whole different part of myself that I was honestly neglecting. So yeah, I'm very grateful for that experience. We talk a lot about school, obviously, because of how we met and, you know, the past teacher student relationship, but I'm glad you brought this up because yeah, it's the work hard, play hard lifestyle. It's the way to go, you know?
Yeah. It's you have to celebrate those wins both ways.
Yeah.
perfect. Okay. So, this is something I sometimes struggle with, is knowing when it's the right time to move on from your last job or role. And you know what, honestly, this is kind of like a hidden, not hidden, hidden to me, but like a bonus of the co-op program is like, it ends. So like worst comes to worst, you hate it 12 weeks, like, you know, like start, finish. But how do you know when it's something is the right time to move on?
Yeah, so that's a great question. And it's something I honestly haven't been able to experience much because every work experience I've had has been temporary. Because I went straight to grad school, I have yet to actually get a full-time job that doesn't have an end date. So, but one thing that I've noticed in the work terms that I really enjoyed and the work terms that I was ready to move on from is that there comes a point in time when you have like an arc of learning and that growth rate starts to slow down. And that could be for one of two reasons. It could be because, you know, you've just learned a lot and there isn't as much more to learn as what you've already learned. But it could also just be because your energy is dropping and you're not putting as much attention into what you're learning and the potential is there and you're just not grasping it. And I think that's when you know that if I'm not as invested now 3 months into this 4 month term as I was 2 months in or 1 month in, then it's a sign that either I'm doing something wrong, but more likely is that maybe it's because, you know, you're ready for the next thing and you're not quite sure about this one. So I think that's been a big difference for me since transitioning over to real estate. Like my learning energy is a lot stronger than it was in anything that I'd done before. And I, even in classes, like I am just putting a lot more of my energy into learning. It's not to say that I'm putting more hours into schoolwork or more of an emphasis or anything, but it's just like I'm learning more than I am completing schoolwork. Yeah. And I think it's the same with any position. It's when you're still like consciously deciding to learn for learning's sake and not because this is a task you need to complete. That's when you know that you're in the right spot. And once you start just completing tasks because you have to, maybe that's when you start to think, am I actually enjoying this or is it time to move on?
Yeah. I think that's perfect. One of my colleagues, she mentioned this, and it was like she did a year. So she did her 4-year undergrad, year master's, and then worked for a year before doing her PhD. And she said that 1 year of work, it was in like a financial analyst or like a relatively junior financial analyst role. And she's like, that 1 year of experience was great, but had I stayed for another year, it would have been 2 years of the 1 year of experience, meaning it was, like you said, no longer growing. And she recognized that, like, okay, like I've maxed out my learning at this opportunity. And there wasn't like the only incentive to staying would have been an extra year of salary, which, you know, isn't nothing, but that's not like her goals were to progress in accounting, progress in finance, and continue her PhD. And staying an extra year wasn't going to fulfill anything other than that one important, but one bucket. And she sought to seek that elsewhere. Whereas like, I need to be very honest. And this is why I think my one friend was like, you are going to be the prof that has the least amount of people go into accounting. And I was like, that's good. Because like, it's hard. Like if you're going to do it, like it's, and you can do your CPA, it's hard. It's an investment, and an investment that like paid off really well for myself and a number of people that I know and a lot of students. But like, there's times that I think if you're not questioning yourself, then you're almost not present. Like you're almost just like, oh, cause it is hard. But, you know, once you're in it, it's like, okay, why am I doing this? And the one thing I want to say is that when I left was when I hit that arc. It was not that it was hard, not that I hated it. That was all the case before, but I hated certain elements. Like I was just like, oh, this is really hard, or people are really mean. Yeah. I don't know. But I was like, I want that designation because I want to take that and go here and here, and I can't get here and here without this. But then when people are like, well, why are you leaving? And I was like, well, if I stay another year, I'm literally working a lot for X amount. Whereas I can go like do basically anything, it's to work the same amount of hours, make X's amount. And like, I would only be 1 year further. Like I would maybe be doing a little bit more review of the work I just did. right? Mm-hmm. But I'm already reviewing work that I did. Like the learning, it may have looked slightly better on a resume, but my actual learning wouldn't have progressed. And so it almost comes to a values thing. It's like, okay, do I want the story to look better? Mm-hmm. What's the cost benefit of that? Or do I want my learning to be better? And what's the cost benefit of that? And just,
yeah,
like you said earlier, just make that, be present, make that decision, and know when to move on. So even though you haven't necessarily had to take, you know, to face something like that yet, I think I really like your rationale, and I think you're prepared for when that does come up, really going back to that learning aspect.
Yeah, I hope so.
Mm-hmm. Are you a big podcast listener, or like book or audio? Like, what's kind of your jam? Like, if you're walking down the street, are you listening to music? Like, what are you doing?
I'm usually listening to music. However, I've been driving to and from campus this year, so I've done a lot of 4-hour drives, and music for 4 hours straight is kind of a lot. So I have started to get into podcasts. Cool. However, I only listen to one.
And that's it's great. Not, I know, I like this.
It's not an academic podcast at all. It's
what is it?
It's called The Tripod. It's the YouTube channel, The Try Guys, and they have their own podcast, and it's hilarious. And it's just an hour of fun, and it makes, you know, a quarter of the drive go by very quickly. So that's really the only podcast I listen to. Otherwise, it's all music.
Cool. Wait, before we got on here, you said that you listened to this sometimes.
Oh, yeah. I'm just bugging you. I watch it with the video, so.
Just the video. Yeah. No, I completely get it. Okay, Try Guys. I'm getting lots of good recommendations just from doing this podcast, so thank you. And I like that you're like very, very focused, Try Guys. Alrighty. Cool. So this is a question that I ask all of my guests. And honestly, there's no right or wrong answer, like there isn't for any of this, but Sasha Paikin, what is your definition of success?
I would say my definition of success is when you have, okay, and I would say this is, for me, success is when you have a lifestyle where it's just your life and it's not like work and life balance. I think once you've figured out how to incorporate everything you're doing into just a lifestyle, instead of saying like, oh, how do you get work-life balance? Like, work is your life. So is like fun activities and other things. Like, it has to all feel just like life. And I don't know if that makes a lot of sense, but that's something that I'm starting to pick up on now. I find that when I'm in school, it just feels like life, you know? And I don't know if that's because I have a lot of independence at school, or I feel as though I make a lot of choices for myself at school, or what it is. But since realizing that, I'm continuously trying to find work that kind of feels like school in that sense, where you know, you're independent, you like what you're doing, you have variety. It's not like you work from 9 to 5 or 9 to whatever, and then you're done work and you can now live your life. Because I find that that's a very limiting mindset, because if you look at it that way, then you really are losing a solid chunk of your day to things that aren't your life and your mind. But yeah, work-life balance, where it's just life, you know, just live your life and have every hour be what you want to be doing in that hour.
I love that. I love that it started off with, first of all, like acknowledging like this is personal, and that's cool, mm-hmm. right? Because I asked you, what's your definition? And saying that success is a feeling, and I can completely relate. Success is, you know, your feeling and what you feel. And I will say that I don't think it's because you're doing your master's or you're in school. I feel very similar in the sense of like, when I align my values with how I spend my time, and you know, how do I some people are like, values are values, or what you were at like 12. And I was like, maybe some of them, but it's like also discovering yourself. I feel like there's a philosopher out there that said you spend your entire life figuring out who you are. And I think that that's kind of speaks to the complexity and the beautiful nature of everything. And, you know, I'm all for people, you know, if they're like, I like boundaries, I like this, or like, this is what I want. Cool. You go do it. But I like when I'm not quite sure. Somebody's like, oh, how much did you work this week? I was like, I don't know. Like, feels like nothing. Yeah. And then I like look back and I was like, oh yeah, like that was like, quote, a lot of like work. And then I've had other weeks where I'm like, yeah, I know I worked like 5 hours or whatever, but it felt like, you know, those were some intense hours, but that's okay. Yeah. 'Cause, you know, I have some other things that I can balance and fit in. So no, it's a feeling, and you invest time, money, energy, other, you know, all the resources, into building the life that you want. So thank you. I think that was perfect way to capture that.
Thank you. And I like how you mentioned values, because I do think that your values can change over time also, as you know, grow up and you learn and you gain more life experience and you gain more perspective. Like, to cement yourself in your values from when you're 18 years old maybe, and have that carry you for the rest of your life, it can be very positive and very powerful. But also allowing some flexibility, I think, is also very positive and powerful.
Yeah. And without, like, you know, going too heavy into, like, as women, we are socialized in a certain aspect. And what may have seemed like bossy as like a 12-year-old, oh, Samantha's such a bossy 12-year-old, it's like, now you're a strong, independent woman. So how society views us, or how certain roles view you, can kind of lead to that. So if I love autonomy. Like, give me a big, scary task and the freedom to like figure out how to do it. I want that. Give me a bunch of direction and micromanage me, and like, it's not going to be pretty, right? So, you know, discovering and understanding that, yeah, you might be uncovering your values. They might be shifting, you know, something that you're like, oh yeah, I really want this. Like you said, it might change, it might shift. And, you know, all those, you know, 20-year-old Sasha who had all the plans, and then, you know, 20-year-old in 3 months, you know, all the plans. If like you stick to a plan when your inner self is like, hey, wait a minute, this doesn't work for me anymore. Like, why? Just because you made a plan, because you told somebody, because, you know, it's okay. Shit can change. Carry those skills, moving along.
Mm-hmm. Definitely.
Alrighty. So before I ask you, well, actually, first of all, if people are listening to this and they're like, Sasha, I want to know more, I want to hear a bit more about your story, or I just want to connect one-on-one, or is there any way that students, or, you know, or anyone that can reach out to you and kind of, you know, have a conversation or an email exchange of some sort?
Yeah, of course. If you go on LinkedIn and you find me, I'm sure my name will be attached to this.
Yeah, you can link it down below.
Perfect. Yeah. You can connect with me on LinkedIn, or I believe my email is in my bio for LinkedIn. So you can also send me an email. And yeah, please do. I would love to meet some more Dal students out of this. And if I can be a help in any way, then yeah, I would love to be. So yeah, I would really like that.
Well, thank you. Sasha Paikin, final comments, anything else to add?
Final comments, take accounting classes with Sam specifically. No, final comments. Dal's great. I love Halifax. I miss it so much. I was there a couple months ago just to visit because I miss it. But yeah, if you're at Dal right now, enjoy your time and go swim in the ocean while you get the chance to.
That's great advice. Thanks, Sasha.
Thank you.